Father, we open our hearts today to you, God. We open our hearts to your word. We open our hearts to the anointings and the ministry gifts that you put in among us, God. We open our hearts, Father, the ears of our understanding, the eyes of our understanding, that we would know the hope of your calling, the exceeding greatness of the inheritance that we have in the saints, the calling and the purpose that you've given us. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Okay? Don't miss any of it. Don't miss anything that God just... And sometimes you need to use your imagination, because some of the things that God is going to say to us are bigger than we've ever heard before. They're more wonderful than we've ever heard before. And you're going to need to use your imagination to picture, to encapsulate, to catch a hold of the next things. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So I just wanted to kind of kick off this morning. By the way, this is not a conference, okay? So I don't want you to be in conference mode. This isn't a conference. This is summit, right? Leadership summit. This is where we all come together and expect to hear something from God and expect to hear it through each other. Amen? That's how God speaks. I've always led even my family through what God speaks to my wife and my kids. And, most of my kids. And, no, I'm just kidding. Sometimes God speaks to us through the people that we're leading, and it's the stuff that you didn't really want to hear, right? But nevertheless, there's tremendous value, guys. There's tremendous, tremendous value in each one of us being able to release what God is saying. Because what God is releasing in India might be just what you need for Nepal or for Myanmar or for Sri Lanka or for Malaysia, right? It just might be just the thing. And I find that a lot of times that I like the prophetic words that other people are receiving better than mine, so I just take theirs. Okay? You can do that. You can just use your imagination, all right, and receive. So I want to talk about what we're talking about today. One track. Okay? One track. And this is a tremendous challenge. But you and I know that if we'll stay on track, we succeed. When we get off track, we waste resources, we waste time, we waste frustration, all kinds of things. But if we can stay on track, we will exceedingly abundantly, above all that you can ask or think, walk in a place of tremendous favor from God. And so I want to turn with you to 2 Chronicles this morning, way back there, chapter 26. 2 Chronicles, chapter 26. And it's the story of Uzziah becoming the king of Judah, or the king of Israel. And he was a guy who started out good and didn't end really well. God forbid. Huh? We start out well and don't end well. Huh? Nobody wants that. But you and I know that there's actually people that aren't here today because they didn't end well. No. Praise God, maybe he'll get a hold of them again, right? And stir them up and set them up again. But my heart's desire is to end well. And honestly, guys, the closer you come to the end, the more important it is to end well. Right? Go out in a blaze of glory, right? God is doing amazing things. And the things that we've stood for all of our lives were truth, and they were effective, and they were real. Now, the people of Judah took Uzziah, who was 16 years old, and they made him king instead of his father Amaziah. Amaziah was a kind of a bad king. In fact, there was a revolt in the nation, and they killed Amaziah. The people rose up and actually killed their king. And then they set his son, who was 16 years old, on the throne instead. Because it was time for a new king, apparently. He was 16 years old. And it says, and he built Elath and restored it to Judah after the king rested with his father. So this 16-year-old guy, his dad's killed. They bury him with his grandparents, all that. They set him up as king at 16 years old, and the first thing he does is build a city. Huh? Any 16-year-olds in here? Who's 16? Anybody 16? Nah, some of you aren't telling the truth. But anyway, Somi, she's always 16. Anyway, can you imagine if when you were 16, you'd have built a city? What would my life look like now if when I was 16 I had built a city? But you know what they told me when I was 16? You'll never build a city. Huh? Isn't it true? That's what they told us, wasn't it? They told you'll never amount to much. You'll never do that. But man, I think if I could have gone back, if I could have captured what I know now when I was 16, well, I'd probably be dangerous. But thinking about it, the situations that we missed and the things that we missed. But this young guy, he started out building a city as a 16. No wonder he became one of the most influential kings ever. Because he did something. He did something. See, do something. Yeah, amen. That's all it takes, right? Just do something. What if I don't know what to do? Then just do anything. Okay, say do anything. All right. That's if you don't know what something is. Just do anything. Got to do something, guys. Everything starts out by us doing something. If I'm looking for people to lead in certain areas of the ministry, I'm looking for the people that are doing something, the people that have built something, the people that have been able to conceive and implement and take a step and get out there and do something useful for the kingdom. And you notice everyone that rises in places of influence, which leadership is influence, it's because they've done something that people can see. That's what makes you a leader. You've done something that people can see. It's very simple. And then it says, he did what was right in the sight of the Lord in verse 4, according to all that his father Amaziah had done. Get it right sometimes, sometimes not. And in verse 5 it says, he sought God in the days of Zechariah, who had understanding in the visions of God. As long as he sought the Lord, God made him to prosper. That's what we're doing here today. We are seeking God in the days of Zechariah. Now, Zechariah was the priest. And God's plan always for you leaders is that you surround yourselves with people that can speak into your life. Surround yourselves with people that can hear from God. Every endeavor that you set out, you need to, first of all, build a team. Gather the people together that can hear from God and that can help you and, amen, and move you ahead. The problem is, the guys that already believe that already believe it, and the guys that don't believe it are just kind of like, yeah, really? I don't have any good guys around me. It's because your eyes aren't open. Terry and I get the privilege of going to a lot of churches, and a lot of times pastors will say, well, you know, we just don't have any real good potential leaders in our church. I say, because it's you're blind. You're blinded. I can walk into your church and I can see all kinds of good potential leaders. And I do. Right? And that's where some of you came from. There's so much potential in people around us. And Uzziah was able to do that, and we'll look at that. But it says here that he prospered because he sought God in the days of Zechariah, and he had understanding. There's a verse in Ezra chapter 5, verse 12 that says that Haggai, well, it talks about Haggai and Zechariah, and they were building the temple. These guys are always building something, right? And it says that the people, or the elders of the Jews, it says they built and prospered through the prophesying of Haggai and Zechariah. Okay, that's Ezra 6:14, and again in Ezra 5:1-2. It talks about these guys prophesying. And they rose up to build. But I love that word. It says they prospered, or they succeeded under the prophesying of these two prophets. So as you're building, guys, you need to have the prophets around you. You need to have the priests around you. You need to have all of the right people around you doing the right things so that we can succeed. Amen? I mean, that's what we're doing here, okay? Talking about what we're talking about. What we're talking about is one track. And we stay on one track because we're one mind, one body, one vision. And we're hearing what God is saying from all of the different parts, right? Every part supplying what needs to be supplied. And so this guy, Uzziah, I just want to kind of skip over his life a little bit. It says he went out to war against the Philistines, and he broke down the wall of Gath. That was where Goliath lived, if you remember. The wall of Jabneth and the wall of Ashdod. He broke down a whole bunch of walls. He built cities around these places. God helped them against the Philistines, against the Arabians who lived near Gur of Baal and so on. And it's interesting to see that he starts building something at home, and the next thing you know, he's building things beyond his borders. Okay? He's building things beyond his own borders. Okay, guys, he begins to build things beyond his own borders. And if you think about your ministry and your life right now, you have a set of borders. They might not be geographical or physical borders, but you have a set of limitations that you see yourself going this far. I see myself going this far. Once you build here, you can build beyond. You can do more. You can go farther. You can increase in influence. You can go beyond your borders, whether your border is a financial border or your border is an ability to influence others' border or gather other leaders or preach the, whatever your border is, you can go beyond that border when you build here. That's what it's about. Okay? So, and I believe that's a word for some of you, that God wants you to see beyond, and I know he does for all of us. He wants us to see beyond the borders that we put in our lives right now. He wants us to see something beyond that. We can begin to build cities beyond our own territory. Amen? That's what Jesus meant, actually, when he said to go into all the world and preach the gospel, right? Make disciples of all nations. Go beyond your own territory. Let's get out there. And so he went out and made war. He built cities in those places. And it says the Amorites brought him tribute. They started paying taxes to Uzziah. His fame spread as far as the entrance of Egypt, for he became exceedingly strong. His fame spread. How many of you here are famous? Okay, a few. His fame spread, right? To get beyond his own borders, your fame has to spread. He's talking about influence. He became influential beyond his own borders. He became influential out there because he built at home. Because of what he built at home, he began to influence. And because he's listening to the prophets and the priests, he began to influence beyond his own borders. He began to take taxes from the Amorites. How many would like some Amorite taxes? Huh? Why not? He began to take. He began to receive tribute from people beyond his own borders because of the way he built. All right? And so when it says that his fame spread as far as the entrance of Egypt, his fame, he became very famous, it simply means his leadership. What did John Maxwell say leadership is? Influence. Simple, right? Bottom line, leadership is influence. That means people know you. People listen to you. People are influenced by you. People follow you. Okay, that's what it means of fame. You said, well, I don't want to be famous. Yeah, you do. You want to be able to influence. What God has put on the inside of you isn't just for you. See, that was one of the problems when I was 16 years old. In our culture, you don't want to be famous. You know, that's for sinners. You don't want to. And you know what I realized is because of that thinking, refusing to become influential because it's not humble, because it seemed prideful to become influential, I missed out on some of the best opportunities a guy could ever had. Just wouldn't go there. Change your culture. You do want to become famous. Okay? And your selfie stick won't help you. That's not the kind of fame we're talking about. Ah, amen. Okay? Fame, in this sense, means influence. Are you able to influence others? Do people look to you as a leader? Do they look to you as an example? That's what happened to this young king. And you'll see why it happened. It says, in verse 9, it says, he built towers in Jerusalem at the corner gate and at the valley gate and at the corner buttress of the wall, and he fortified them. He built towers in the desert. He dug wells. He had much livestock, both in the lowlands and the plains. He had farmers and vine dressers in the mountains of Carmel, for he loved the soil. For all you farmers there, there's your verse. And he had an army of fighting men who went out to war by companies according to the number of their role, as prepared by Jael, who was one of his extremely organized assistant, associate administrators, which we have lots of around here. So this guy was a scribe, and he was an officer under the hand, another guy, an officer under another guy, and talks about all the captains and so on. So the total number of chief officers and the mighty men of valor was 2,600. Hey, he had 2,600 key leaders. And under their authority was an army of 307,500 fighting men, and all the war went to war with mighty power to help the king against the enemy. And Uzziah prepared them for the entire army, shields and spears and helmets and body armor, bows and slings to cast stones. And it was a real busy time. It was a real busy kingdom. How's your kingdom? Real busy? Man, they were building stuff. They were making stuff. They were putting towers up. They were working in the soil. They were doing all this kind of stuff. And we're talking about one track. Huh? When we grow, we got to grow in a lot of areas. And this is a struggle I went through this for years. You remember Tommy Barnett in Phoenix? The big thing about his ministry was that he had 56 separate ministries in the church. And people went to his conferences to learn how to have something for everybody. Right? I mean, can you imagine? 56 ministries in the church. And this was a miracle style of leadership. And people would flock to his conferences every year to learn how to do that. How can I? I've got 200 members in my church. How can I have 56 ministries? And then we see a great shift into, no, let's just knock it back down into pruning, 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 pruning. And we have to prune so that what has life will have more life. We've got to be able to prune things down. And so there's a great movement. And for me, that was one of the biggest struggles of my life, because we tend toward multiplicity. We tend to get this going and that going and this going and that going. And you know, we tend to have too many cars. And you know, how many guitars does Joey have? You know, like, is that one track? You know, to have 20 guitars? You can only play one at a time. So we're thinking about pruning and pruning, pruning. It gets very confusing. And to me, it was really a challenge, because what am I supposed to prune? If I prune stuff out of the ministry, we prune some of the things that are doing, playing key roles. Are we supposed to prune continuum media out of the ministry? I thought about it. Those of you that's your heart, you're like, no, don't. Are we supposed to prune the Bible colleges out of our ministries? No, don't touch that. And you look at this guy, and he was very successful and very influential. And one of the reasons was because he was able to keep all of the things that he was doing, or he was able to do things that were all happening on one track. They were all for one purpose. And our purpose is reach, teach, mobilize. Okay? That's our vision. And if that doesn't scare you, your vision's too small. How many of you are comfortable reaching, teaching, and mobilizing right now? Because we could... Huh? So this guy says he loved the soil, he had vineyards, he had towers that he built. And then one of my favorite verses is down at the bottom in verse 15. It says, he had many devices in Jerusalem invented by skillful men to be on the towers. And it says, so his fame spread far and wide, for he was marvelously helped until he became very strong. He had devices that he built on the towers. Actually, it says in some translations, it says engines. The guy built engines. They were machines that would do things. They were infrastructure on which you could build things, or which you could do more than you could before. How many of you build systems into your ministry that allow you to do more? Amen? That's what we're looking for. We fight to do those things. We fight to get those things working right. We want to have systems that will allow us to do more. Engines. Devices. Right? Things that will facilitate the vision and the purpose. Things that will multiply your energy. And that's what engines do, right? The fulcrum thing, right? Leverage. Leverage your influence. Leverage your abilities. Leverage what God has put on you. Put a magnifying glass on what God's put on the inside of you so it gets bigger. And so that's what this guy did. And it made him one of the best leaders ever. Very interesting. It says his fame spread and he grew stronger and stronger until he became very strong. Maybe there's no other word for it, so it's just stronger and stronger until you become very strong. Very influential. He was a great, great leader, very successful leader. So when you look at his life, and I'm intrigued by it, because I love the way that infrastructure allows us to increase. Yeah. Pastor John's just finished his building in Myanmar. That is going to allow him tremendous increase. He'll have a place now to have his Bible school, all of those kind of things. It's going to be able to bring increase. Every time you put a new system in place, or you get some new equipment in place, or you get new whatever it might be, it's for the purpose of increasing, reproducing more and more and more. And that's our goal. You know, you think with the Bible College right now, we're renovating the Victory Asia Bible College in Sirachad and putting it into the lighthouse and opened up more room. Why not have 70 students instead of 10, right? Start with 10. You know how we do it, right? Jesus had 12 disciples. When you start a Bible college, you just pray and you say, God, if you give me 12, then I know it's you. And then 8 people come and you say, it's okay, this is fine anyway. We're going to do it anyway, guys, right? Sign from heaven or not, it's something God put on the inside of us. And he's given us a command, right? Make disciples, train them up. And so there we are, building infrastructure that allows us to increase what we already have. But then, what's the date today? September the 6th? September the 6th, 2016. That's what happened to Uzziah. September the 6th, negative 2016. I don't know what year it was. Things were going really well. He was doing the things he loved. Don't you love doing the things you love? Man, I love our worship group. Isn't it cool? I love seeing worship groups springing up in new churches. I watch you guys all on Facebook, and there's a church in the Philippines that just had, you know, a couple of guitar players before, and now they got a full band, and yes, thank you, Jesus. How's your worship group? You got some good guys, don't you? Yeah, and getting more all the time, right? Because once you get some, it attracts more, right? And those of you, you know what? If you put a priority on worship, you will have an amazing worship group. Leaders, if you don't put a priority on it, you won't have it. Don't think you're going to get it if you don't put a priority on it. You got to encourage these worship leaders. I mean, can you imagine? I mean, my wife and I started out as worship leaders, believe it or not, way back in the day. You know what's cool? That guitar Joey's playing this morning, I bought that in 1975, the year I got born again. Isn't that cool? Yeah. Praise God for Fender. Anyway, it's neat to see that things can keep increasing. And in the Philippines, you guys have so many amazing natural gifts in music, and you just attract more and more and more. And Pastor U and Renee, they've just started doing worship nights in their church with a full band. I just can't wait to get down there. I was going to drive down there last week just to see it. Because to me, that's so exciting. It's so very exciting. If you give energy to it, it'll succeed. You just keep pushing it. Just keep pushing it. If you give energy to planting churches, we'll plant churches. Amen? If we give energy to training leaders, we will train leaders. There may be a few bumps on the road, but we'll do it. So this guy, Uzziah, he gave his energy to farming and protection, to defensive military systems, to offensive military systems. He gave energy to raising leaders. I mean, he had, 2,000 and some key leaders, and he knew exactly where everybody, no wonder he became so successful. He had a plan. He had an idea. And he set it out, and he said, this is how we're going to do it, and this is all of the things that we're going to do, and we're going to have resources coming from the land and from the hills and from the enemy and from the people. And there's going to be resources coming from all these different streams. We're talking about one track. He's going to have all these different training programs going on, and he's going to have, you know, Sunday school. Don't prune your church by cutting Sunday school. Okay? God has put a creativity on the inside of us. And you get some tremendous ideas. And sometimes you think, well, man, I'm too busy. Well, that's because your last idea is too clumsy. Put it together. Build an engine out of it. Okay? We got lots of engines. Now, those engines aren't our purpose. They're our tools. Your Bible college is not your purpose. It's your tool. Okay? The goal isn't Bible college. And every time we've had somebody in the ministry whose goal is Bible college, we've run into trouble. It's not a biblical goal. That's not the goal Jesus gave us. I don't even like the word Bible college, and I tell people I never went. Right? It's not what we're doing, is it, guys? We are a frontline Great Commission force in Syria and across Asia. That's who we are. We're not practicing. We're doing it. Right? This isn't just try it and see if you like it, man. We're doing it. We're committed. It's a platform. It's a church. Okay? Your goal isn't to have a great church, a big church, a pretty church. Your goal is to reach, teach, and mobilize. And when we reach, teach, and mobilize, we're on one track. And all of those things will be built all along the tracks everywhere you go. There'll be stuff springing up that's just absolutely wonderful, and you'll be able to handle it all. Why? Because you've got one track. So I want to talk about what is that one track. See, for us, it's easy. We can say, yeah, reach, teach, mobilize. We stay focused on that. Right? We use all of these other things to build. There are equipping, there are tools, there are infrastructure, there are systems, there are all of the things that we put in place so that we can reach, teach, and mobilize. Any idea that comes along that helps us reach, teach, and mobilize. I don't care if it's planting a vineyard. Right? Let's do it. So, then what happened to Uzziah? And that's the interesting part. In verse 15, it says that his fame spread far and wide, for he was marvelously helped until he became strong. He was marvelously helped by God. Are you helped by God? Man, I tell you, it's just amazing, isn't it, what God does for us? We're here because of what God's done for us. Amen? I mean, look at you all. Come from all kinds of different places. I never realized that from Sirica to Subic Bay was 18-hour trip. It's only 2,000 kilometers. I could have walked faster if there was a path to walk on, but there isn't. So we came anyway. Amen? Okay? So it doesn't matter what kind of difficulties you face. We know where we're going. Amen? We know what we're doing. But here's the problem. In verse 16 it says, but when he was strong, his heart was lifted up to destruction. Oh, seriously, come on. When the guy was 16 years old, he built a city, and he was rewarded for it. He built armies. He built towers. He subdued enemies. He expanded the kingdom. And God rewarded him and rewarded him and rewarded him and rewarded him. And he knows better. But today, September the 6th, he's got a decision to make. And his heart is lifted up. What does that mean? Well, look at me. Huh? Take a picture. Aren't I something? His heart was lifted up. Do you know, one of the reasons that worship is so important is because we put our heart in the right place. Do you notice that people that skip worship and skip church, pretty soon their heart is no longer in the right place. They can't even make a right decision. This guy couldn't make a right decision. He'd grown up and prospered under the prophesying and the priesthood of Zechariah. Those guys prophesied into his ministry, prophesied into his life, and it grew and expanded and expanded. He did amazing things. He released creativity in his ministry like nobody else. And I love that. You see that? He got people doing stuff that had never been done before. I love it when you guys come up with something that I've never heard before. Some creative, why don't we do this? Yeah. Right? See, he'd built a culture where creativity flourished. And my heart's desire is that in Victory Asia we have a culture where your creativity can flourish. Where when you get a new idea, nobody's going to come along and say, well, that won't work. Huh? Well, that's not going to work. Well, I could think of 10 good reasons why that won't work. Well, good for you. Huh? I grew up in that culture. That's why I didn't do anything when I was 16. That's why they thought I would never amount to anything, because I was already always told that won't work. So I started lying, because there was stuff in my heart I wanted to do. And I can remember I would go and get my dad's toolbox out of the garage, and I'd be heading out somewhere, and I was going to build an airplane. Right? Or a rocket ship. Or maybe a high-speed train running through the bush. Whatever. And he'd say, where are you going with those tools? And I learned to say, nowhere. Because if I told him I was going to build a rocket ship, what would he say? You can't do that. Yeah. Nobody on a farm in BC builds rocket ships. What's the matter with you, kid? I actually built a plane one time. It's a good thing it never flew, because it would have crashed. A neighbor came over and he said, what is that? Full plane, full-size plane I built. And yeah, he wouldn't let me fly it. He was a pilot. So I bought a hang glider and I flew that. Man, oh man, release creativity. Do you know, you think about the church in Lethbridge, what are they known for from the outside, from over here? Creativity, right? Pastor Kelly and his group, they're known for their creativity. We love to see them come. He brought his team to Thailand last year, or a few months ago. And yeah, we just want to release you guys. Tell our guys all about creativity, all you can. Tell them about creativity, how to release that creativity. So you got to build places that are conducive to creativity. You've got to preach sermons that are conducive to creativity. You've got to release opportunities that are conducive to creativity, that people can see a way that they can fit in and do something and build something. And one of the biggest complaints that we hear as we travel around from just people when we're talking, I just don't feel there's a release for me here in this church. I just don't feel there's any way, place for me to fit in, man. Does your pastor know you feel like that? So if anybody in my church feels like that, you better come and talk to me. Huh? Anybody feels like you're not being released? Come and talk to me. I can either figure out why you're not being released or release you. That's the goal, right? So instead of keeping his heart right, which seems to be a tricky business, he let his heart be lifted up in pride. King Uzziah, look at me. I've got towers over there, and I've got vineyards over there, and I've got armies behind me. Now he's number one. That's the wrong kind of fame. See, pastors, you take that. If you've got one of those flow charts, you just turn it over. Okay? Put the bottom on the top and the top on the bottom. We don't allow flow charts in our ministry, actually. Because I think they're stupid. I've never seen them produce anything good. You can always tell who wrote the flow chart. It's the guy in the top box. Because he's trying to organize everything. And that's fine. It helps. And sometimes I'll draw pictures and do stuff like that. But I don't want you to feel like I'm the top dog. Paul said God has put us apostles last as servants to serve the body of Christ, as pastors to serve. Amen? Don't you love being in churches where the pastors serve the people? It's the churches that grow. So what does he do? He comes to a junction, guys. His heart's lifted up for destruction. So he transgressed against the Lord his God by entering the temple of the Lord to burn incense on the altar of incense. And Azariah the priest went in after him, and with him were 80 priests of the Lord, valiant men. These were valiant priests. And they withstood King Uzziah and said to him, "It is not for you, Uzziah, to burn incense to the Lord. It's the priest's job." The guy went into the temple to burn the incense on the altar of the Lord. What's the matter with that? It wasn't his anointing. It wasn't his calling. It wasn't his job. And he did it because he was so proud that now he thought that he should be able to do all the jobs. He did it because now he's so smart, he should be able to do everything. You'll never be that smart. Sorry. And in fact, the smarter we get, the more we give to other people. Amen? And what happened? The priest came in and said, "Hey, buddy, we are not going to relinquish, we are not going to give up our anointing or our authority or our calling for you, O rich and famous king. Sorry." And they withstood him. With 80 valiant, I love that, valiant priests. Priests are valiant. Man, you think of them as these soft little guys, but no, they were valiant guys. And they went in and they withstood him and said, "You get out of here." And that was his downfall. That's where he missed the track. The one track that we're talking about is the anointing and the calling on your life to do what you're called to do, and to not do what someone else is called to do. To do what you're supposed to be doing, and do it well, and do it effectively, and do it powerfully, and do it growingly, expandingly, and not cross over to do what someone else is called to do, because now you think you're so smart that I could do your job better than you can now because I'm really smart. It's not about being smart. Right? It's about being where you're called. You've got to know, is offering incense to the Lord a bad thing? No, it's just not your job. Is going into the temple a bad thing? No, it's just not your job, King. It's the priest's job. Don't touch it. This wasn't like a little, you know what, you shouldn't do that. No, he actually lost everything he had over this one thing. He lost everything he had because his heart was lifted up. And he said, I want that ministry. I want to do that. I want to do it like so-and-so does it. Okay, we're going to change the whole church, and now we're going to do it like Tommy Barnett does it. He had a good thing going. I don't know where he is now. Tommy, he's probably still around. Probably got a great church. But everybody that's tried to copy somebody else hasn't got it. Got it there. Pastor Kelly and I were having coffee a couple months ago on the street in Lethbridge, and we were talking about, you know, how he's branded his church. No perfect people. These are Canada stories, so you can't tell anybody, okay? There's a stage in Asia, what happens in Asia stays in Asia. And so he's talking about some of the other guys are saying, yeah, we should all brand our churches like that. That's the guy that said, it won't work for you. It won't work for you. You can't steal somebody else's idea, like somebody else created me, what I've got, and just impose it on you. It's going to be frustrating anyway. You know? Now, you can brand your church the same as Pastor Kelly's. It's something that comes out of your heart, but you can't do it because it's his. You can't do it for that reason. There's lots of things that we can implement and copy because they're good ideas, but it's got to come, man, it's got to come from your anointing in your heart. And this, you know that this is going to work for you. And the why is there, not just the how and the what. I'm compelled to do this. This is part of my passion. It'll work. So this guy goes into the temple, does something that's just not his ministry at all, and he loses everything. Loses the whole thing. Guys, I'm not telling you this because God wants to hinder us by saying you can only have this and you can't have this. He wants to flourish us. He wants us to flourish. He wants us to be satisfied and happy and quit worrying about what somebody else is doing and how they're doing it better, and just look at what's on the inside of you, the inside of your team, the inside of that anointing that God has put on your life, the call that God's put on your life. That's what it is. And you can reach, teach, and mobilize that. You can run on the one track with that. But as soon as you try to shift it over into somebody else's anointing and calling and book or whatever it may be, then you're going to get off track. So this is for increase. But the other thing it's for is if you could just relax and say, you know what? I don't have to be like so-and-so. I'm quite happy being just Al. Huh? That's a happy place to be. I don't have to be. Now, I can glean and receive from all kinds of ministries, and we do. Love it. Listen to all kinds of different strains and stuff too. But I'm not going to copy them. I'm not going to try and be them. Because there's something on the inside that God has put on the inside. And what he's put on the inside of me is just as real and powerful as what he's put on you. And it'll work for me better than what you've got will work for me. And what is in here won't work very well for you. But what's in here will work well for you. See, that's all it was. He just got off track. And there's more stories of disaster than we can have time to tell about people who tried to copy someone else's ministry and got off track. Now, in closing, I want you to just go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Again, remember, it's not a seminar. And as we get going here, we want to have more and more interaction. Hear what's going on, when I know what's going on, right? So we can just casual out and hopefully get to spend lots of time with your buddies and your friends and mix it up. Go home with new stuff, right? In 1 Corinthians, this is Paul talking, and he's talking about, you know, the difference between Paul and Apollos and all those kind of things. And he says in verse 13, is Christ divided? I mean, 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? He says, I thank God that I didn't baptize any of you except Crispus and Gaius, lest anyone should say that I had baptized in my own name. Oh yeah, and I baptized the household of Stephanus too, for God. Besides, I do not know if I baptized any other. Verse 17, for Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Is baptizing a good thing?
Yes. Interesting, eh, that he would say that? Paul had such an on-track mind. He couldn't get him off it. You know? he was a real hard nose that way. He said, Christ has not sent me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Now I want you to write down on your paper there, Christ has not sent me to blank, but to blank. Okay, can you do that? Can you write that for me? Okay. Christ has not sent me to, put a blank there, and you can leave a whole page if you want. But he has sent me to blank. You've been time for your homework. Christ has not sent me to what? It's interesting that Paul would say Christ has not sent me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Now there's obviously a way you can look at that, which we need to understand, is that when you preach the gospel, people will be baptized. Isn't it true? Do you remember Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch, right? The guy's riding along in his chariot and reading out of the book of Isaiah. And Philip says, do you understand that? And he says, no, come on up in my chariot and explain it to me. And so they're reading out of Isaiah. Where in Isaiah does it say to be baptized? And what did the Ethiopian eunuch answer when Philip explained Isaiah to him? He said, then what hinders me from being baptized right now? And then I found that really interesting, because the fact is, if you preach the gospel, people want to be baptized. Now, whether Philip explained baptism to him or what, I don't know, but that was the result, okay? So when Paul preaches the gospel, the result is still baptism. Don't get me wrong. Baptism is a good thing. Jesus used the phrase that believe and be baptized. Okay? How many of you believed and be baptized? Are you baptized? Anybody here not baptized? Let's do it, right? Let's go to the river, man. Baptism is great. But Paul said, Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Okay, so I want you to fill in your blank there. Christ did not send me to act like Pastor Oop. Christ did not send me to do the same thing that John is doing. Christ did not send me to copy Pastor Kelly. Christ did not send me to, okay? And you can put on all kinds of really good things in there. I'm talking about one track. You've got to know what Christ has called you to do. You've got to know what you're anointed to do. You've got to know what that gifting is on the inside of you to do. And it's not that easy to write it down in one word. Anybody can write down preach the gospel. Right? But you know what? When you preach the gospel, it's different from when you preach it. And it's different from when you preach it and from when you preach it. It's different. It comes out different. It comes out according to the gift. But you have to know what that is. And I encourage you, over this few days, spend some time thinking about this. What is it really? Because you know what? I want you to become famous. I want you to be able to build the systems, release the creativity, raise the leaders, attract the people that will make you an influential leader across the boundaries that are in your life right now, that you can begin to build beyond your own boundaries and further and expand and grow. And to do that, you have to know what Christ has not called you to do and know what he has called you to do. And then don't let anybody criticize.
Well, you know what you're going to do? It's not the way I do it.
Of course it isn't. It's the great thing about it. Thank God that you don't all do things the way I would do them. Man, we just all look like me. Now, this is probably one of the most difficult things that I've ever done, is to figure out what it is. And the reason is because it scares you. It's scary to be able to to identify. Christ has called me to see a region of nations, of victory churches, with thousands and thousands of churches across Asia. That's scary. It's the ones that you think about when nobody's looking and nobody's listening. It's those ones that you think about when you're laying on your bed at night and you can't sleep. It's the ones that starts with, if only. If only I could. That's the ones we're talking about. There's a guy, Phil Cook. He's a media guy, works in Hollywood, great Christian guy. He wrote a book called The One Big Thing. It's a really good book. It helps you go through that process of figuring out. I've read that book a few times. And just to get you thinking about what it is. Because you know what? If we can focus, right, all of our energy and all of our resources onto that one track, you got to be able to see the track. You got to be able to see what it is. You got to be able to know very clearly what it is. You got to be able to know so clearly that when something else comes along, it's no. That's not it. Because as a leader, the greater your influence, the more people you'll have telling you what to do. Who don't want to do it, they just want you to do it. I only listen to people who want to help me do what they think I should do. You okay? All right? So don't be afraid to put a whole bunch of good things in that spot. Now, in January, my wife and I decided to take a sabbatical. So we are going to, I'm going to go hide for 3 months with my Bible, and just push through and hear from God. You know, what's interesting is when I got born again and lived in Canada, in northern Alberta, and it's really cold there, you know, it snows this deep outside and it's 40 below outside, and so you would just stay in the house with the fire going and the teapot on. And I spent one winter, an entire winter. It's the most amazing thing. Totally set my life up for everything that's come out of life and ministry for Terry and I. And we didn't have electricity, just an oil lamp. And I would be there at the kitchen table with the oil lamp in front of my Bible, and I had a lexicon and a concordance, a few things like that. That was it. And I would start reading and look up at the clock and it'd be 6 the next morning. Never even knew that the night went by. Because the Word of God is so rich. And everything you need for life, family, and ministry is buried in that Word. For people then to dig it out and press in and get a hold of it. And to pray, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, that I know the hope of his calling. And that opened up many, many miracles. And that first book, On to Perfection, came out of that. Many miracles. That's how we were able, as a family, who lived in a house with no electricity, or telephone, or running water, to move our family to Asia, and be successful in ministry. Because of that, that's that Word. And so, as I feel like, guys, as Victory Asia, as our lives, as us as individuals, and personally, we're at a point right now where we need to shift again. And we need another one of those. I need another one of those. I need another one of those times where it's just, you know what? It's just, you're just going to hear something new from God that's so revolutionary that you'll think nobody ever heard it before. But you know what I discovered is somebody's always heard it before, if it's truth. But nevertheless, it's like that for you. It's so fresh and powerful. And so that's what we're going to do. And I want you to know that, but the reason I mention that is because when you look at sabbaticals and how to do it, I've been kind of looking at it and seeing what other guys do. And Pastor Dave Myers did one, and he said he read, you know, like 5 books a week. Started at 4 in the morning, and, you know, he'd read. And I'm thinking, you know, it's such a struggle reading books. Because I get into them and they start out real good, and then the next thing you know, they're not saying anything. I don't have time to read something that isn't saying anything. Like, if you could write it in one page, just do it. Huh? Don't try to impress me by how long your book is. And so I feel like reading books is a good thing you need to learn. But for me, reading books is not a sabbatical. It's a chore. Okay, now for you, it's not. I don't know how many of you love to read. I love some of you guys, I'm just so refreshed. I'm like, man, when I start reading, I'm like, this is work, buddy. It's like me back in high school, they made you read those books. And so I was listening to this one guy, is it Seth Godin or somebody like, some very well-known leadership guru. And I was listening to a podcast, and he says, yeah, I never read books. I thought, well, now there's a new way of thinking. Set me free. Huh? Because you know what? I have this fear that there's something in a book that I'm not getting. I got to read every book in the world. Well, you can see them. They piled up on my iPad. They piled up on my desk. They piled up in the bookshelf. But you know what else I discovered? If there's something good in a book, Pastor Kelly will tell me about it. I can probably even get it in a Facebook post, you know? Like, there will be the highlight. Do what God has called you to do. Be who God has called you to be. One track for your life, but not trying to copy other guys. Be influenced. Listen to the prophets. Work together. But you are you, and we don't have another you. And we need you the way you are. We need you to be who you are, because that's how we're going to flourish. That's how we're going to have an army 2,000 kilometers. It's how we're going to be able to build cities beyond our borders. It's how we're going to be able to expand our influence, our leadership across the nations of Asia. There's a lot of Asian nations yet that don't have bigger churches.